Lecture 1 for the Advanced Interpreting Techniques in Civil and Criminal Matters course. It's actually the fancy name for this class, but it is really nothing else than a preparation for the oral component of the federal exam. One of the reasons why we have that fancy name is because the state of California, those students, those interpreters in the state of California that want to take this class for continuing education units, we have that approved, and they don't approve any class that reads preparation for any exam. So the title is a little bit misleading, but that was the only way we could get this approved. In other states, we didn't have any, we could have called it preparation for the federal, but we want to be consistent. Just a reminder that students who are on site here, if you're in California and you're taking it on site, this will be considered to be instructor led, meaning that you will get 35 units instructor led. If you're taking this online, it will be non-instructor led. Okay, so that's the difference between the two, and you should be aware of it. Now, you should all have a course syllabus, and those that are online also downloaded that, most likely when you went to lecture one and you already have that. It's basically a pretty simple course syllabus that basically describes what we are going to be doing here. But let me discuss with you briefly what are the objectives of this class. The first thing that we want to do is learn the differences between how the federal system works and some of the key players in the federal system and compare them to state court if we have to. The second thing we're going to do, starting even today, is consecutive techniques. In my experience, I noticed that most people that are working in the court system, they don't necessarily have the best consecutive technique, and that's such a big thing in the federal exam. So I'm going to introduce to you a technique that I have developed. In fact, I will be publishing a book by the end of this year on this particular technique. Very interesting book, and I'm just going to give you the basics, okay? And we're going to be practicing. So the idea in this lecture number one is to go over some key terminology, and I don't want you to start practicing consecutives before you have learned some of the techniques. Because you come here with different techniques and bad habits, let's see if you can, you know, if this actually corrects that. Now, I also like to tell students when I teach a consecutive technique that if you already have a technique that works, then use it. But pay attention to this new technique because you may find this you may be able to adapt certain things from the technique to your own technique. If you find that your technique doesn't work, I always wonder why do you keep using it? But people like to use it at all times because they don't want changes. So I know it's going to be difficult to change, but just make an effort to do so. Okay, we're going to be, and once you see how it works, I'm sure you will be you will like it. Now, what usually happens after a while is that I introduce a the technique that I developed, and you already have a technique or you want to adapt that to you, and you can certainly do that. Nobody's going to ask you what technique you use. The only way they will judge you is by the interpretation, how accurate it is. So it doesn't really matter if you use a different technique. What really matters is that you deliver an accurate rendition. As you all may or may not know, the federal exam has a consecutive that has the longest segment is 75 words long. There are two segments like that, and it's not easy. But we're gonna tackle that problem first. So because that's the one that is gonna take the longest. The idea for behind any technique or any new technique is that you also have access to a lab so that you can practice. And you all have access to a lab. Students who register on site, you just basically go to interpreting.com. And during the break, I'll show everybody, once we are off the air, so to speak, I'll show you how to access. But students who are online, you do know how to access because you received that information, and you probably already accessed the lab. I'm going to tell you at the end of each session whether you should do some practices and what practices to do and which ones and so on and so forth. I want to guide you through that consecutive. So the idea is that for the next 2 weeks, 3 weeks, we're going to spend time in doing consecutive. Then we're going to get into site translation because that's the second killer, the second difficult part in your federal exam. The site reading, particularly the one from Spanish into English. And usually they have traditionally kept the same type of sight readings. And that's good news. We're going to be doing different variations of power of attorneys in Spanish or family law matters in Spanish. But it is pretty tough because of the restructuring. So we're going to learn techniques, and then we're going to be doing some of those sight readings. Then we're going to look at vocabulary that it is more common, commonly used or high-frequency words in the federal exam. One of the things that you may notice is that they're very heavy on things that happen in airports, for example. I mean, they do a lot of stuff, a lot of cases in airports. And therefore, when you deal with an airport, you deal with check-in, curve, the gate, and things that we do know what they mean. But when you are given those things in a simultaneous where you don't have time to think, you really have to have a good idea of the translation and practice it a lot to be able to do that. So we will be looking into that after we complete our sight translation journey, so to speak. That will probably take us up to week number 6. Then week 6 to 7, we look at those keywords. And then from 7 to 9, we do simultaneous. In my experience, most of the students that take that class that are certified, either in the state of California or any other state, if you're certified, simultaneous probably is a pretty good component you feel comfortable with. But there are 2 simultaneous in your federal exam. There's one that it is one person talking, and there's another one where it's a monologue, and the other one is a dialogue. And the dialogue is a very fast speed. It's a question and answer session from English into Spanish of an expert witness. In there, the expert witness could be talking about, I don't know, maybe forensics in computers or whatever the case is, and you have to be aware of the vocabulary as well. So we do a couple of weeks on that, and then finally, the last 2 weeks, we are going to be doing mock examinations, put it all together. This is going to be a difficult class, telling you from the very beginning, okay? It's going to be difficult, not only in terms of the technique, but also in terms of the words that you're going to be exposed to, the vocabulary. We're not going to be talking too much about legal terms necessarily. We will look at some legal things today in terms of the differences or how the system works, the federal system works. But really, we want to get into more like general vocabulary, opening and closing arguments and things like that, get the necessary speed, and also expert witness testimony as well. So that's pretty much what this course syllabus is about, all right? That's all. Now, we have, for those of you who are here, we have a midterm and a final exam. And for those of you who are online, we have exactly the same thing. If you are an online student in week number 5 during the midterm, you will be contacted by an online evaluator over the phone, and you will be tested for about an hour or so. And you will be doing simultaneous and consecutive, whatever it corresponds. I'll give you some hints as to what's coming your way. And the final exam for those of you who are online will also be the same. It will be what we call our second over-the-phone evaluation. You schedule them for the first one in week number 3, and for the second one, I believe, in week number 8. Make sure you schedule it at that particular week, because if you don't do that, you won't be able to watch lecture number 6. Okay, so you need to schedule it and be ready for that exam. Okay, it's good that you are assessed for the first assessment anywhere between lecture 4 and lecture 7, and for the last one, obviously, after lecture 9 or 10. What I wanted to tell you is that online also, if I give you a written exam here, they will also be able to download it. Now, I don't know if I'm going to give you a midterm and a final, to be honest with you. If I notice that we need more work in class, I'm just going to give you a take-home midterm or take-home final. It's up to you if you do that. Because my main goal is to make sure that we get those techniques right and sufficient practice. Taking a whole period of this class for a midterm or a final might be a little bit too much. 2 years ago when I taught this class, I did give you a midterm, and that was it, no final. And the midterm was all written just to force you to study for what was coming next, which was vocabulary that will be used in the simultaneous. So I may do that, I may not, I will let you know. If I notice that we need more time, if I have to, I will extend this. I know the federal exam is coming up pretty soon, but I will find ways to actually even give you some class on, put it online so you can watch it, whatever is convenient. But we need to get all these techniques ready, and that's pretty difficult to do in 11 weeks of training. The good news is that most of you have the simultaneous, but not everybody has the simultaneous. You know, some people have problems with it. So basically, that's what this course syllabus is all about. If you have any technical problems, you will have access to an online lab as an on-site student. I will show you during the break what that entails. We do have here, you can send an email. All the information is here in the course syllabus. And you can ask, any technical difficulties you have, we will reply to you right away. Any questions on this? I have to introduce myself. My name is Nestor Wagner, and I will be teaching this course. This is the preparation for the federal exam. My email is wagner@interpreting.com. And the phone number here is 1-800-625-6222. Okay? All right, so if there are no questions, then we are going to begin. And the first thing that we would like to do is look at the key vocabulary in federal court. One of the things that that helps you a lot in the exam is the knowledge of the system, because you may know how it works in state court, but you may not know how things work in federal court, and the players and the keywords and the participants and the keywords that are usually associated with it. So for the next 45 minutes or so, I will be explaining that with the corresponding translations, and you'll become familiar with it, hopefully. And then we're going to go into consecutive technique, okay? So all cases begin with a crime. So somebody commits a crime, but not all crimes are federal crimes. Of course, crime is delito federal. You can say delito en la jurisdicción federal or delito federal. You could also say delito en el fuero federal. It depends how technical you want to be. My suggestion, delito federal. Keep it simple. Simple at all times, particularly for simultaneous. A federal crime is defined when the federal government is defined as a crime where the federal government is a victim. If I commit murder and murder of a regular resident of the state of California, that's a state crime. But if I commit murder in the state of California of a federal employee, then that's a federal crime. Or if I commit murder by going into a federal building, then that's a federal crime. Or if I use the post office to send anything that could be considered to be a crime, such as, for example, committing fraud through the federal U.S. post office, that's a federal crime. So, and the main thing that we need to know is whether the federal government is a victim, and also if the crime is committed in a federal highway. There's a typical thing called interstate shipment, which means the shipment between one city and another using a federal highway. A federal highway is a highway that has usually the letter I, interstate. Mm-hmm. So for example, here in Los Angeles, Las Vegas is pretty close by, it's about 200 and some miles. There's an interstate road called I-15. If you commit a crime anywhere on that road, it's a federal crime. It doesn't matter in what state you committed the crime, it's still a federal crime. So typically, one of the crimes that you will see is when they transport goods and they, for example, the truck driver stops to take a break, and then somebody comes and steals whatever the merchandise or the goods that they have in the truck. That particular crime is going to be a federal crime, and it's going to be called, interstate shipment. It has to do with interstate shipment, so we're going to see that clearly. So there is a difference between criminal and federal, state and federal, in terms of whether the federal government is a victim, or any entity of the federal government is a victim of the crime. Of course, it's also a federal crime when you cross the borders of the United States. So that's why we have drug-related cases, and so on and so forth. That's why in the federal exam, there's a lot about airports and stuff like that, because the airport is a federal place. So a crime committed at the airport, it becomes a federal crime. if you don't go through the metal detectors, that is a federal crime, even though it may be the airport, New York, and it could be LaGuardia, but still it's a federal facility, okay? So, and of course, drugs is, if you cross the borders and commit a crime, that's also a federal crime, like bringing an illegal alien, for example, or, you know, kidnapping and removing the person from the, taking the person to another, to Canada or to Mexico, for example, that would be considered a federal crime. Once a crime was committed, then it starts with, the system starts, and then you have what we could, they call interviews, which are entrevistas, of course, investigations. Investigations, you can use investigaciones, but you could also translate this as averiguaciones. Averiguaciones. It's fine. There are, both are correct terms, whatever works for you. Arrest, and then a complaint is filed. Now, the first thing I want to point out is, what is a complaint in federal court? Is it the same thing as a complaint in state court? It is somehow the same. In the federal jurisdiction, the federal government can file charges against a defendant two ways. By writing, preparing a complaint as they do in state court and taking it to the, usually the U.S. magistrate. Could be a U.S. judge, but usually the U.S. magistrate. And with that complaint, asking the U.S. magistrate to look at it to see if there is probable cause, like in a preliminary hearing in the state court. And if the judge determines that there is probable cause, then the magistrate determines that, then they issue an arrest warrant and they go and arrest you. That's one way. Another way is to go to a group of people called the grand jury and bring evidence to the grand jury. And the grand jury looks at the evidence and decides if the, and of course the grand jury can ask, can subpoena people to testify, can ask subpoena evidence and all that. And the grand jury, there is no defense there, the defense is not present, and the grand jury decides, yeah, I think there is sufficient evidence, there is probable cause. And if there is probable cause, instead of a complaint, they will issue an indictment. Regardless of which way you go, the translation for both is the same, which is acusación formal. Complaint and indictment. We make a distinction here. This is acusación formal. But we make the following distinction. When we talk about complaint, it's acusación formal por el gran jurado. Gran jurado. And complaint by itself is just acusación formal. The same thing actually happens at state level, but in the federal level is much more noticeable. So first of all, who files that? Those charges against somebody who commits a crime in the federal jurisdiction, and where do they file them? Well, if I'm a, I'm going to be called a U.S. attorney now. And a U.S. attorney, you know that in the federal government, everything was based out of D.C. And many, many, many years ago, judges will do a circuit, will go to different states, and that became a circuit. It became a district and a circuit. In that circuit, you have district courts, and you have also circuit courts. Circuit courts. In that district, you have a U.S. attorney. In fact, the district might include, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 states. So there are different regions within each state that you have a U.S. attorney. It's like in state court, a head deputy DA, like you know what a head deputy DA is, the deputy DA that is in charge of an office in one area of the county. Well, in the federal jurisdiction, you have U.S. attorneys that are in charge of a certain area. For example, there is a U.S. attorney in charge of the Southern District of California. It's a female, Mary something is her name, I believe. There is also a U.S. attorney in charge of District Court of Northern California. So the district is a word you're going to see, and this Northern or Southern California is basically a subdivision of that district. Because the area where we are here in California, it's a district that includes California, Oregon, Washington, Alaska, Hawaii, and within those states, there are divisions, divisions. And there's Southern California, the Southern District of California, Central District of California, Northern District of California. Each of those districts, there's going to be one U.S. attorney, which in Spanish we're going to call it Procurador Federal. Now, this U.S. attorneys that are in a division within that district report to the main attorney, which is called the Attorney General in Washington, D.C. So what you have is you have an Attorney General, just go here, an Attorney General in Washington, D.C., and there are U.S. attorneys, many of them, a lot of them, and the U.S. attorneys are in a certain area of that district, and the U.S. attorney has a lot of assistant U.S. attorneys. And there are a lot, because the U.S. attorney is like the DA here. You got one DA in this county. And they hire deputy DAs. The ones that you will be dealing with generally in court are called assistant U.S. attorney. So let's look at transfers of these terms, because these are important terms. We know that U.S. attorney is Procurador Federal. And Attorney General is Procurador General de la República. That's how it's used in Mexico. You can use that. Some countries, they use Procurador General de Justicia. Attorney General. So Attorney General, Procurador General de la República. It's pretty long for a simultaneous. So most people say Procurador General for Attorney General, just to keep it simple. And for U.S. Attorney, Procurador Federal. General for Attorney General, Procurador Federal for U.S. Attorney. And for Assistant U.S. Attorney is Subprocurador. And of course, it is Federal. So if we were to look at these terms, the Attorney General, which is only one in Washington, D.C., is Procurador General de la República. General, de todos. Then in each district, there are going to be several U.S. attorneys. They are going to be known as Procurador Federal. And each of these U.S. attorneys needs some people to help them prosecute individuals in federal court. And those are going to be assistant U.S. attorneys, which are going to be subprocuradores or subprocurador federal. The party that you will be dealing with, I mean, you will hear these three terms in many places in your federal exam. People fail a lot of portions of the exam because they don't have this clear in their mind. Attorney General, Procurador General. U.S. Attorney, Procurador Federal. Assistant U.S. Attorney, Subprocurador. And if you don't want to say Federal, it's fine. There's only one Subprocurador anyway. So those are the parties. Now, the Attorney General represents, who do they represent, the Attorney General in Washington, D.C.? They represent the whole government, the U.S. government. So the U.S., it's like in the state court, we say that the DA represents the people of the state of California. Well, in federal court, the Attorney General represents the U.S. government, okay? So the U.S. government no es el gobierno federal. Es la Procuraduría Federal. Procuraduría Federal. And so the U.S. government, la Procuraduría Federal, is represented by the Attorney General. Es representada por el Procurador General. Because there are different districts, porque hay varios distritos, in each district, and each district is really very, they're very large, these districts, so they have subdivisions within each district. And each of those subdivisions will have a U.S. attorney. Like Southern District of California, Southern District of Florida, Northern District of New York. And each of those U.S. attorneys, which are known in Spanish as Procurador Federal, will hire people to go to the federal court and to actually help them And those people that are higher are known as assistant U.S. attorney, which in Spanish, it's known as subprocurador. And if you have time, you say federal. If not, you just leave it as subprocurador. Those are the parties that correspond to the prosecution overall. Okay. Any questions on that? The defense is much easier. Isn't it too cold here? Okay, sorry. It's very cold here. You're online. You don't feel it, but we do. So. Okay, so coming back to that, we know what the prosecution is. Now, the defense is just the defendant. Now, the defendant can be represented by private counsel, abogado particular, abogado patrono, if you want to use that. Abogado patrono is used mainly in Mexico, but abogado particular is perfectly fine for private counsel. Or he or she could be represented by, they call it a federal public defender, deputy federal public defender, that's the exact name. Deputy, let me just go to the next page. Deputy Federal Public Defender. This is identical to the public defender that represents people at the state level. You know that there is only one public defender at the state level, one person, and that person needs help, and they are known as deputy public defenders. So the ones you actually see in court, they are really deputy public defenders. In the federal jurisdiction, the same thing occurs. There's one federal public defender, one person, but then that person cannot be in every courtroom defending people in the federal jurisdiction. So that person hires other attorneys, and they are known as deputy federal public defender. You could translate as defensor público federal, to make it simple. Defensor Público Federal. Linguistically, because it has the word deputy, you should say Subdefensor Público Federal. Every time you see assistant or deputy, it's always sub, viene de subalterno. It's the one that reports to the federal public defender. Remember, assistant U.S. attorney is the one that reports to the U.S. attorney. So, but you don't have to use sub because they represent the federal public defender. And in court here in California, a public defender, we don't say defensor público. We just simply say defensor público. The same thing happens in the federal jurisdiction. You don't have to say subdefensor público federal. You can simply say defensor público federal. And another interesting thing, because I tried to shorten these translations, because the speed sometimes in the federal is 165. We don't want to have too long of terms, transfers. And the other thing is that why do you have to say federal? If you are taking the federal exam, we all know that el defensor público es federal. So there's no need to say it. So it's such a long term as deputy federal public defender can easily be transferred into Spanish in the federal, either in court or in the federal exam, as simply defensor público. That's good enough. You don't have to say federal. That's why indictment es acusación formal por el gran jurado. But if you are in the federal jurisdiction, why do you have to say that? Just acusación formal is good enough. You don't have to say it necessarily. So this thing, procurador, for example, U.S. attorney, procurador federal. Why do you have to say federal if you are in the federal jurisdiction? Just say procurador. Now, deputy federal, assistant U.S. attorney, which is subprocurador federal. Why do you have to say federal? You are in the federal jurisdiction. Just use subprocurador. Now, attorney general, you have to say procurador general. Okay. So in other words, to simplify things, you could translate for U.S. government just procuraduría. For attorney general, procurador general. For U.S. attorney, procurador. And for assistant U.S. attorney, subprocurador. This all works fine. Keep in mind that for attorney general, you have to say procurador general. You cannot eliminate el general because then it confuses with the other one. And when you look at indictment, acusación formal, there's no need to say por el gran jurado. We all know that. And deputy federal public defender, just defensor público. You don't have to say federal. It's unnecessary. Shorten the renditions, the transfers, because at the speed that you're going to be using these terms, it's going to be pretty difficult to use the whole expression. Now, of course, if you're doing a site translation and you come across these terms, clearly you can use the more formal transfer. But I don't think it's necessary. Just get used to the simplest way to render it, okay? Any questions on this? So we have the prosecution and the defense. Question? Yeah, U.S. government, you can say La Procuraduría. You don't have to say La Procuraduría Federal. We are already in this federal jurisdiction. Okay, there's no need to do that. Now, some people say, wait a minute, can I translate, for example, U.S. attorney instead of procurador? Can I use fiscal? Okay, now here's the dilemma with this. In some countries in Latin America, we do have La Fiscalía Federal, and we also, in other countries, we have La Procuraduría Federal. In Mexico, for example, fiscalía is a term that is not used. So it's not really a good option for Mexico, but for other countries it is. The question, of course, is, well, as far as I know, in the federal exam, they will take either one because they don't localize to any given country. But just get used to one, whatever you like. If you want to change, you know, fiscal, in the case of U.S. Attorney General, you will have to say fiscal general, which is very odd. I personally like Procuraduría, Procurador General, Procurador, Subprocurador. That's actually much more federal than anything else. But again, if you see it in a list of vocabulary glossaries, it doesn't mean that it is completely incorrect necessarily, but it is not elegant. What's elegant is keep Procuraduría for federal jurisdiction and Fiscalía for state jurisdiction. That's way more proper. Okay, so we got those two things. So where is it that these cases are heard in federal court? Well, they are known as district court. As a matter of fact, it's called U.S. District Court. And a U.S. District Court is actually equivalent to, at the state level, to the state courts at state level. And state courts, I don't know if you remember that, but a state court translated into Spanish as Tribunal de Primera Instancia. At the state, trial court, excuse me. At the state level, trial court is the same thing as U.S. District Court at the federal level. At the state level, we transferred trial court as Tribunal de Primera Instancia. A U.S. District Court is actually the federal court where trials are heard. And that's why this translates into Spanish as Tribunal Federal de Primera Instancia. This is where federal interpreters work. If they don't like the outcome of a case, any of the parties, they can file an appeal, and they will file the appeal at the U.S. Circuit Court. And there are no interpreters there, because the U.S. Circuit Court refers to appeals. And that will be Tribunal Federal de Segunda Instancia, o de Apelaciones. We like to say the Segunda Instancia because you also have U.S. Appeals Court, which is the Apelaciones, which is the same place. It's really the same. So when you see, this is the most important one, U.S. District Court, Tribunal Federal de Primera Instancia. Now, question here, do you have to say federal? Not really, we are in the federal jurisdiction. So when you see U.S., when you use U.S. District Court, just simply say Tribunal de Primera Instancia, because we are already in the federal jurisdiction. In a site translation, I will be more elegant and add the word federal. But if we are taking the oral exam and simultaneous, just drop it so that you have fewer words, the equivalent is much shorter. Now, so the system, the way it works is that either a complaint is filed, which is acusación formal, or an indictment, una acusación formal. Por el gran jurado, pero still acusación formal. The complaint is when they take it to when the U.S. attorney or assistant U.S. attorney takes that to a judge, a federal judge, and asks the judge to determine if it is valid. And if it is valid, I mean, what's another way of saying is that if there is probable cause, motivo fundado. If it is valid, then the case begins. It's like in the state court, a preliminary hearing, really, where there is some testimony and all that, and then the judge binds the defendant over. Finally, the trial begins after that. If it is an indictment, then they take everybody to the grand jury, take all this evidence to the grand jury, okay, gran jurado, and then they decide, and then the grand jury will issue an indictment. The proper way of saying it is they will return an indictment, which means aprobará una acusación formal, will return an indictment, aprobará una acusación formal. Aprobar, to return, aprobar, no devolver, aprobar una acusación formal. What about this issue of, what is a U.S. magistrate? I mentioned that word. What's the difference between a U.S. magistrate and, for example, and a U.S. judge? Of course, once again, when you look at the word U.S. judge, it technically means juez federal, but we are in the federal jurisdiction. So, you know, you can, if the simultaneous is very fast, just simply say juez. It's good enough, right? Okay, the difference between these two is very, very clear. Do you, in California, we have a similar difference between what we call a judge and a commissioner. There are commissioners in California, I don't know if in other states, but what happens is that judges that work in a given courthouse, and judges are appointed by the governor of that state everywhere, or elected, and those judges, usually, let's say there are 20 judges in a courthouse, they need help. And then the governor is not appointing anybody. There are no elections, and they need help. So they all get together, and they sort of approve certain attorneys to work as judges. They are known as commissioners. The same thing happens at the federal jurisdiction. U.S. judges that work in a certain district court, Tribunal de Primera Instancia, get together and approve certain individuals, you know, attorneys, of course, to work, but they have not been appointed by the president. In the case of the federal jurisdiction, the appointment comes from the president. This U.S. district judges get together and say, okay, let's pick this person to help us in this district court. That person, because that person was not appointed by the president, will be known as a U.S. magistrate. And technically, a U.S. magistrate is appointed to serve a term of 10 years. But here's the big issue with this. U.S. magistrates cannot hear felony cases in federal court. They cannot. They are very limited. All they basically do is arraignments, bail hearings, and take pleas. And when they take plea and it is a felony, the district judge, the U.S. judge assigned to that, one of the judges in that district court, will have to approve even that. So the question is, how do we transfer this into Spanish? Okay, we know that this is juez federal. Now, can we use for U.S. magistrate as magistrado federal? And the answer is no, because in Spanish, magistrado refers to an appeals judge. If you look at the word magistrado in a legal dictionary in Spanish, it means juez de apelación. So we have a big problem dealing with U.S. magistrate, because in Latin America, the system is not the same. Judges cannot get together and appoint people to another judges to help. And that's what creates problems with the rendition of this term. So the question is, what will be a good, do we have an equivalent term in Spanish? No, because the systems are completely different, and this particular position called U.S. magistrate doesn't exist in Latin America. So how do we transfer that? Well, most people still transfer this as juez federal. So it's the same. You see, in Spanish it's the same. But we need to know that although it has the same linguistic transfer, they are not necessarily the same. A U.S. magistrate cannot do the same thing that a U.S. judge does in district court. So when they have the word U.S. magistrate and U.S. judge next to each other in a simultaneous, just use juez federal for both. Just keep it simple, okay? This magistrate. Yeah, they cannot hear felonies.
So they can hear what?
No, well, they usually hear, yeah, Well, misdemeanors, there are not too many in federal court, but they usually hear, for example, arraignments in a felony case. They usually hear bail review hearings. They usually take pleas, and when they take the plea, that has to be signed off by a U.S. judge.
I was asking to see if we can.
If you can
put
find
a name
it,
to the
yeah.
That they hear, so that we can call it or whatever.
Anything that doesn't have that has nothing to do with waiving on giving up constitutional rights. So in Spanish, we have something similar called juez de garantía. You might have heard that word. And that has to do with respecting jurisdictional rights and all its, constitutional rights. And we could say, juez federal de garantías, because that's pretty much, but it's really guessing. The term that is used everywhere for U.S. magistrate is juez federal. So let's just keep it like that. Now, do not use magistrado. It is incorrect, okay? It is incorrect. You know, we have the same problem in state court. We don't have this word comisionado in Latin America. So, for a commissioner, we still use judge, juez. It's the same issue, the same problem.
Can you shorten both on the
simultaneous? Juez, yeah. You can shorten because we are already in the federal jurisdiction. Now, so after this takes place, the prosecution really, so we have a crime that is committed. And then after the crime, things enter into the system. What does it mean by that? Well, here is where we have the interviews by the federal agents. Because one interesting thing is that these are not police officers that take care of this. The federal government has their own agencies. If this is related to terrorism, for example, it's going to be probably the FBI. If it's related to drugs, alcohol, or tobacco, it will be DEA or drug, alcohol, and tobacco. If it is related to any other different jurisdiction, they may have different special agents for that purpose. Regardless of the crime, in the federal jurisdiction, they are known as special agents, which in Spanish is the same thing, agentes especiales. Some people use agentes federales. It's your call which one you use. Those special agents are the ones that take care of this. They basically have the same role that state police has, but at the federal level. That's why when you go to the federal level, you see you have the DEA, you have ICE, you have so many different entities, and you say the DEA, the FBI, ICE, and all that, and we need to know those names because those entities are enforcement entities that are the ones that investigate people that commit crimes. Which one is the agency that it will investigate? A defendant depends on the crime that was committed. We all know that if it is drug-related, it's DEA. We know that if it is immigration and customs-related, it's ICE. We know that if it is terrorism, it's the FBI. Okay, so we need to learn that, and if it is smuggling customs, which is also ICE, actually it's the same. So we need to learn that, and we will learn them here, okay? Now, once these agencies investigate all this, then they send information to the U.S. attorney for that district, Southern District of California, Northern District of New York. And the U.S. attorney takes the case. And when that happens, then we start into a phase called prosecution and pretrial. So now this U.S. attorneys, which indeed is not a U.S. attorney, it's more like assistant U.S. attorney, because the DA here in Los Angeles County is not the one who prepares all the complaints. Who prepares the complaints? Most likely it's going to be a deputy DA or a head deputy DA. And in federal jurisdiction, it's not necessarily the U.S. attorney. The U.S. attorney will sign it, but the one preparing is going to be the assistant U.S. attorney. So they prepare that, and they decide whether they're going to go with a complaint or an indictment. And if they go through the grand jury, it's going to take way longer than if they go with a complaint. It takes way longer. Now, what happens in this prosecution? Well, the charges are filed, okay? To file is promover. So las acusaciones se promueven. Where are they filed? In the U.S. District Court, in el Tribunal Federal de Primera Instancia, o tribunal de primera instancia. So, the assistant U.S. attorney, el subprocurador, files charges, promueve las acusaciones, in U.S. District Court, en el Tribunal Federal de Primera Instancia. Those charges will be filed, esas acusaciones serán promovidas, through either an indictment, a través de una acusación formal, por el gran jurado, or a complaint, o una acusación formal general. A complaint, when you put this indictment and complaint together, indictment, acusación formal por el gran jurado, you don't have to say emitida, just por el gran jurado, and indictment, and complaint, acusación formal general. So if they say in the simultaneous, they said, you have the option of filing a complaint or an indictment, dice, tiene la opción de presentar una acusación formal general o por el gran jurado. I don't have to say acusación formal twice. Okay. And then they begin with the appearances, las comparecencias. Okay. There are issues like preliminary hearing, just like in state court, audiencias preliminares. They deal with bail. They do bail review hearings. Audiencias para rever o para analizar la caución, bail review hearings. Review hearings. O reconsiderar. Audiencias para reconsiderar la caución. Para reconsiderar la caución. And these are identical to state court hearings. In fact, the same principles apply. Whether the person is at risk of flight, un riesgo de fuga, and whether the person is a danger to the community, un peligro para la comunidad, and whether the person has substantial ties to the community, si tiene lazos importantes con la comunidad. These are all things that are evaluated in a bail review hearing. And during those pretrial services, during the pretrials, that's where if the charging document, el documento acusatorio, is an indictment, es una acusación formal por el gran jurado, this is the period where the grand jury keeps receiving evidence or makes, variations to the indictment. Because here is a problem. When the grand jury issues an indictment, cuando el gran jurado expide una acusación formal, that indictment cannot be changed. Esa acusación formal no se puede modificar. Cannot be amended like you do in state court. No puede ser modificada. If there has to be a change, like for example, you're investigating these guys and they realize that instead of not only they were dealing drugs, but they also were dealing weapons, and you want to add that count, they have to bring all that information to the grand jury. The grand jury looks at the new information and gets a copy of the original indictment, and the grand jury will now decide whether to add that particular count. And it will change the indictment. It will be amended. That indictment, when it is amended, it has a name in federal court. It's called superseding indictment. So a superseding indictment. Spanish we translate it as acusación formal supletoria. Suple la reemplaza a la original. So during this prosecution and pretrial, things are very dynamic. There are arraignments, appearances, this and that. And then the indictments can be amended. And if they are amended, then clearly the grand jury has to receive the evidence and has to approve that. And when they approve it, that indictment has a name now. It's called superseding indictment. If originally the case was filed through a complaint, a federal complaint, and you want to add more charges, then the assistant U.S. attorney will add the charges, will go to a magistrate, U.S. magistrate, and show probable cause, and the U.S. magistrate will approve that. So two ways. A judge approves probable or determines that is probable cause, or the grand jury. And if it is a complaint, it doesn't change name. Still called federal complaint. right? But if it is an indictment, it changes to a superseding indictment, okay? Indicating that the grand jury has approved it, okay? Now, after that, when they're ready to go, then comes to what we call the actual adjudication, the actual case, that this is identical almost to, we call this adjudication, which is procesamiento de la causa. And in that adjudication, we have the first thing that happens, this is where the U.S. magistrate is also involved. Arraignment takes place, instrucción de cargos. You have trials, juicios. In this trial, if it is a felony, which most of them are, we will not have a U.S. magistrate. You're going to have a U.S. judge hearing that trial. But at the arraignment level, most of the things that you're going to see are U.S. magistrates. Now, one interesting thing that I want to discuss with you. When you hear the word complaint, which is acusación formal in the federal jurisdiction, it automatically means that that is a felony. If you hear the word information, which is also acusación formal, that automatically means that it is a misdemeanor. It happens to be the opposite that it is here in state court in California, because an information in California is for felonies and a complaint is more general. But at the state jurisdiction, you also have information, but it's used for misdemeanors, and they also transfer as acusación formal. For us, it really doesn't matter whether they use information, complaint, indictment. For us, it's still acusación formal, no difference whatsoever. Mm-hmm. But it's a good idea to know that, because if you are interpreting in federal court and it is an information, you're not going to see a U.S. judge, you're going to see a U.S. magistrate. In fact, most, for example, if you research initial appearance in federal court, what happens there, they're all going to say, you know, the U.S. magistrate, because that's the U.S. magistrate deals with all those initial appearance, with arraignments, takes care of all that, because the U.S. judges are very busy with felony cases. And when we hear complaint, they go, it's a felony, so eventually may start with the U.S. magistrate in the arraignment, but eventually in the trial it's going to be switched to a U.S. judge. But if it is information, it may start with a U.S. magistrate in the arraignment and may continue with the same U.S. magistrate. So it is possible that a U.S. magistrate will be in charge of a trial, but that trial will be in a trial where the charging document is an information because it's a misdemeanor. The requirement that is placed on U.S. magistrates is that they cannot hear felony cases. So and then of course after the trial we have sentencing, if found guilty, and conviction. Sentencing is conviction. This one is imposición de la condena. De la condena. Conviction is condena. Trials, of course, son juicios. And you also have what we know guilty pleas, right? Este declaración de culpable, or change of pleas. When it comes to sentence, if the person is found not guilty, no problem. But if the person is found guilty, then there is some sentencing, which is la imposición de la condena. And then after that, if the person is found guilty, you end up in the corrections area. We call it corrections. It's the penitentiary that we all know, the federal penitentiary, the penitenciaría federal. Part of a correction doesn't have to be just sending the person to prison, to federal prison, but it could also be probation. Probation is the same thing, libertad a prueba, libertad condicional, condena condicional, they are all correct translations. And prison, a federal prison, it's un penal federal, if you want to. So prison is penal. Sometimes you may see U.S. Department of Corrections. That is, if you see it, U.S. Department of Corrections. If you see that, it translates into Spanish as one translation, Centro Federal de readaptación social. In Mexico, abbreviated as CFRESO. CFRESO. At the state level, you may remember that Department of Corrections at the state level is Centro de Readaptación Social, el CERESO. But at the federal level is el Centro Federal de Readaptación Social, CFRESO. U.S. Department of Corrections is a term you need to know for your federal exam. So the question that you should ask me is, do I have to say Centro Federal de Readaptación Social, or can I say el CFRESO? You can say el CFRESO, it's shorter. Because nobody can penalize you for that. Now, if you start using terms that are more common in Mexico in terms of legal terms, please don't mix it with terms that come from South America, like fiscal. Continue with procurador, okay? Just be consistent. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're almost finished with this, and then we'll get into techniques. Question? Yeah, this is all localized to Mexico. Yeah. CERESO, Centro de... Just eliminate el federal. Si es estatal, es Centro de Readaptación Social, el CERESO. Of course, always normalizing, localizing to Mexico. Let's look a little bit about initial appearance and the type of motions that are usually filed. Oh, by the way, do you know that at the federal jurisdiction...
What if we don't want to localize?
You don't have to localize. Yeah, sure. For U.S., the question is, if you don't want it localized, U.S. Department of Corrections, can you use a more general term? Well, you can use a term that is used, for example, in South America, que es una Dirección General de Rehabilitación Social. Rehabilitación. You can use Dirección General de Rehabilitación Social. It's going to give you trouble because they don't have an acronym for that. Rehabilitación Social. Yes, the U.S. Department of Corrections is the same thing as the U.S. Bureau of Prisons. I was going to mention that. So it has the same translation. You wouldn't say el Bureau de los Penales or anything like that. It's still the Bureau of Prisons is U.S. Department of Corrections, and it transfers into Spanish as Centro Federal de Readaptación Social, or CFRESO, if you want to simplify it.
Will we be penalized if we use CFRESO?
No. If you use CFRESO, you're fine. No, absolutely not. Now, you know that you may or may not know this, just for your information, that I'm just going to give you the exact date if I find it here. Obviously, I can't find it now. Just give me 1 second here. Okay. Parole was... repealed, the idea of parole was repealed by Congress in November of 1997. That parole, libertad preparatoria, only applies currently for crimes committed before 1997. It was repealed in November of 1997, just to keep, for your information. So the term parole may or may not come out in the federal exam. It's very unlikely, because if they keep it updated to what's going on right now, probably not. Parole, it was the idea of parole, the concept of what parole is and that privilege was repealed by Congress in November of 1997. So people that were charged with a crime after November 1997 can never be on parole, but before they can. Okay? Just for your information. Oh, well, no. Parole and immigration is a completely different issue, okay? It's not going to be part of the federal exam, but I briefly will tell you what it means. Parole basically is giving the person permission to enter the country, you know. Es un permiso anticipado de ingreso al país. Sometimes that parole is when you don't have the documents or there are certain issues, but it's not going to be something that will come out in your federal exam. The only thing that you will find in immigration, it comes out all the time. But the only thing you could find in a federal exam that deals with immigration, at the most, will be agencies such as ICE, things like that. It's not going to be too deep into immigration.
Can you say for parole,
if you in immigration,
right.
If you could say salvo conducto, salvoconducto, if they understand it. If you see the word parole in immigration is a temporary permit to access and to get into the country. And that's, you can say salvoconducto de ingreso, you can do that. O este permiso para un anticipado para un ingreso al país. You can explain like that. But don't get it, don't think that that's going to be in your federal, it will not be. Now, in the initial appearance, we know what an initial appearance is. The federal court is slightly different than state court from this point of view. In state court, somebody gets arrested, goes to an arraignment. In federal court, somebody gets arrested and within 72 hours goes to an initial appearance, comparecencia inicial. It's not a place where they are going to enter a plea. It's the time for the defendant, for the judge to read the charges and to advise the defendant advise him of his right to have an attorney. That's all it happens. So the initial appearance, as we know it in the federal jurisdiction, it's non-existent really in the state jurisdiction. In the federal jurisdiction, again, they have to tell somebody who was arrested, they have to tell that person why he was arrested, and also that he has the right to have an attorney. After that, that gives the person time to get an attorney, or an attorney is appointed, which will be, of course, a federal public defender. What happens next is that the next step is the arraignment. That sort of matches the state jurisdiction. Exactly the same thing that happens in an arraignment in state court, except that the document, charging document, could be complaint, could be information, or it could be indictment. That is sort of new. Indictment is more common. When they have an indictment, they have a much better description of the crime. So we're going to see some of those. Just for your information, they generally do not come out in your federal exam. But just for your information, I'll give you a couple of copies of that. Now, after the arraignment comes a part which is called discovery and motions. Okay, so we know what discovery is, revelación de pruebas, or divulgación de pruebas, whatever you want, revelación de pruebas, or divulgación de pruebas. That's discovery. And we know what motions are, motions pedimentos. We look at some basic motions that are filed at this stage. So I get arrested, and then I go to the initial appearance, and then they take me to an arraignment. And sometimes in the federal jurisdiction, in the arraignment, there is already an offer and everything is settled. Like in state court, it happens usually after the arraignment because the plea is always not guilty in an arraignment. In the federal jurisdiction, it could happen that during the arraignment, they already have an offer and everything. Because why? Because they already had an initial appearance, and then there is a period of time between the initial appearance and the arraignment to actually have a conversation between both attorneys and to try to settle the case. Then after the arraignment comes a period called discovery and motions, okay? Revelación o divulgación de pruebas y pedimentos. What are the typical motions filed there? And we haven't gotten to the trial. Then after this period comes the trial. Okay, these motions are important for your exam. You obviously, the defense will file, for example, motion to dismiss charges. We know what this means. Un pedimento para, and here's an interesting point. Dismiss, if you remember from previous classes, it means sobreseer. But it was dismiss a case. To dismiss charges, you can, if you want, use sobreseer las acusaciones. O simplemente, you could also say, this is where the confusion comes in. Desechar las acusaciones. Have you heard that term? That in some dictionaries they register, dismiss, desechar. It's not what I like, but you can use it. Desestimar. That's also used. You can use desestimar. So when the dismissal is of charges, you have much more, you know, flexibility in what you use for the term. But I personally believe that if you already know sobreseer, use sobreseer. So, para sobreseer a las acusaciones. Um, you can, you know, you can look at it from this point of view. I mean, if somebody's testing you in a written exam, I can ask you, for example, what would be the proper, can you transfer dismiss charges as desestimar las acusaciones? And the answer is yes, because they are charges. But can you transfer dismiss a case, desestimar la causa? No, unless it's an appeal. See, when the dismissal is of a case, desestimar only applies at the appeal level. When the dismissal is of charges, it applies any time.
So
sobreseer una causa, always, always, yeah. That's why when you look up these words in a dictionary and you see all these options or in a glossary, they're all correct, but you have to know how they are used, in what context they are used. Now, I doubt that the federal raters know this, so I guess you can use whatever. I doubt that they know this. Sobreseer, you will always be right, so just be on the safe side. So that will be one type of motion. The other one is the typical one that you will also hear in court here, which is motion to suppress evidence. Double P, evidence, which is, of course, un pedimento. And now to suppress, some dictionaries register para eliminar, para suprimir pruebas. I mean, I like pedimento para dejar las pruebas sin efectos, para dejar las pruebas sin efecto. If it's too long, you can definitely use pedimento para eliminar pruebas o suprimir pruebas. It's your call. These are filed by the defense, by the way. There is another motion that is typically filed by the defense. It's a motion to introduce evidence at trial. Typical motion. So let's say you are in the federal exam and the dialogue at 160 is not between somebody asking questions, an assistant U.S. attorney and an expert witness, but rather is between a judge and an attorney. They may be talking about these type of motions, okay? That's not going to be fun. So this translates as pedimento para presentar, you can use introducir, it's fine, pruebas en el juicio. The prosecution files some motions as well. These are the typical one for the defense. Very, very common. The prosecution will also file motions during this period. And the typical ones that the prosecution will file are as follows. So the next ones come from the prosecution. It will be, for example, motion to request reciprocal disclosures, or disclosure. What this means is that the prosecution wants to know what the defense intends to present as evidence, and in exchange, so it wants to know what that is, and in exchange the prosecution would let the defense what they present. It's sort of a discovery. So what it is, motion for discovery in the state court, in federal court, it's generally known as motion to request reciprocal disclosure. Can you say un pedimento para revelación de pruebas? Sure, I would probably say pedimento de divulgación recíproca de pruebas. Pedimento para la divulgación o de divulgación recíproca de pruebas. I do want to use the word recíproca because it's I give you this and then you give me that. I know. You can say this. Well, it's long
it's
long in English. So you can say pedimento de divulgación. Yeah, the recíproca is a problem. Motion to request reciprocal disclosure. So there's five words and we have six words. That's not too bad. And then the other one that you will hear, and then we'll finish with this, is the motion. Oh, what did I touch here? 1 second. Motion for defendant to disclose alibi. If there is an alibi. Es un pedimento. Para que el acusado divulgue su coartada. So after this discovery and motion period, after all this is taken care of, a trial begins. It's just like a regular trial. The person is found guilty, sentencing, imposición de la condena, takes place. Not guilty, then obviously the defendant is released. And after sentencing comes what is known as post-trial proceedings, which we interpreters don't participate in, but just to, so that we finish the whole process. Post-trial proceedings son diligencias posteriores al juicio. So just to have that post-trial proceedings. Diligencias posteriores al juicio. And what are those? Well, the appeals. Where is the, there are two appeals that people, I mean, they, there are a maximum of two appeals. If I am found guilty, I don't like the fact that I was found guilty, and I feel that I should be not be found guilty, I can appeal to the U.S. Circuit Court, Tribunal Federal de Segunda Instancia. Sometimes it's also known as U.S. Appellate Court, Tribunal Federal de Apelaciones. If they decide against me, I can request to appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court, la Corte Suprema de Justicia. But let me tell you that most of the times the U.S. Supreme Court only hears very, 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 very few cases. So if they don't hear the case, if they dismiss it, lo desestiman, then the decision made by the U.S. Appellate Court or the U.S. Circuit Court is final. There's still one more option for the, two more options for the defendant. The defendant can file an habeas corpus proceeding at that point. So we have habeas corpus proceeding. It's usually known as a petition for habeas corpus, but it's a habeas corpus proceeding. In Spanish, we translate that as juicio de amparo. And this habeas corpus proceeding or petition for habeas corpus occurs when the defendant feels that his or her constitutional rights were violated, in the, or constitutional rights as far as the case is concerned were violated. And that's why it's known in Spanish as juicio de amparo. Amparo es protección. Que si yo presento un juicio, que es una acción legal, para ampararme, para protegerme, según la Constitución, conforme a la Constitución. Porque no me permitieron tener un abogado, porque el allanamiento de mi, del, el allanamiento que ocurrió en mi domicilio fue ilegal, porque no había una orden de cateo firmada por el juez, porque lo que se obtuvo entonces no debería haber sido presentado en el juicio, qué sé yo, varias formas de presentarlo. Sí, generalmente ese es el argumento que se presenta en la apelación, pero si la apelación no está de acuerdo y uno quiere hacer la segunda apelación ante la Corte Suprema y no le permiten hacerlo, puede presentar un juicio de amparo. And the last one, if that doesn't work, is a presidential pardon or clemency. Pardon. Que es un indulto presidencial. Esto es indulto, no perdón, ¿eh? Indulto presidencial. You shoot for that? Nobody gets it. Very few people get it. You know who gets these presidential pardons usually? At the, when a president is at the end of his or her term, that's when they give those pardons, so they don't have to deal with it. Now, this basically completes the key terms, legal terms, from the beginning till the end. In federal court. Any questions before we take our break? Okay, so the plan now is we're going to take a break. I know that those of you who are attending this live or online, now you're going to be able to, you finish with this lecture, then you can just click on the lecture one after the break, after this, okay? So this really ends lecture one for these, we're going to call this class preparation for the oral component of the federal exam, because the too long. Advanced interpreting techniques in criminal and civil matters. It's just too long. Fancy words so that people are happy there in San Francisco, okay? All right, so let's take a 20-minute break. Thank you. Now let me show you how to access.